This is a little hard for me, but anyway, we're going to talk first about constructs and what the meaning of a construct is. And then he said, let me think about it. We have to decide. We haven't gotten into yet the question of whether or not concepts are useful, whether or not concepts are good or bad. We haven't evaluated the content of concepts, constructs. So first we'll be going into the group called constructs. And then there are three different characterizations of constructs from the sutra where the Buddha explained what he really had in mind. And those are explained given on page 22. Beginning from about the eighth line from the bottom. And then there are three characterizations of constructs given. One is called number tope chuyu, and I'm not going to even attempt to, I'll just translate what the words are, and then we'll get into the meaning of it, which means that object towards which imagination does its thing. Okay, that object towards which imagination functions. Then the second one is the characteristic which is the place of imagination, okay, and then the signs of something which is a factor. Now those don't mean anything to me so far. They're just three expressions, but those are used to describe constructs. And then Geshe-la says, remember that constructs are directed towards shenwang. Constructs are directed towards things which grow from their causes, things which are dependent. So even though constructs are not dependent things, they are directed towards dependent things. So there's a relationship between constructs and dependent things. And I don't quite understand it myself, because what he's saying is that constructs apply, or constructs are used, or constructs are directed towards dependent things. So hopefully he'll explain it further. And so that these three characterizations of constructs are stressing the fact that they apply to or are directed towards dependent things. So in order that you can understand the idea of these three features of constructs, how they apply to a dependent thing, we'll take an actual example, and it'll be easier to see how these three features of constructs apply to dependent things. So let's take the dependent thing called sukh. Sukh in Tibetan can either mean all physical matter in general, or it can also mean the object of the eye, meaning shapes and colors together. And Geshe-la introduces this sukh as saying, you know, the one, for example, that goes along with sounds, smells, tastes. That clarifies that it's the one that refers to what you see with your eyes, shapes and colors. So we're going to take the example of shapes and colors, visual objects, and then we're going to examine how these three features of constructs somehow are directed at or applied to the things which we see with our eyes.
What is this?
This is getting difficult, but it's okay, I think. Visual objects, constructs are directed at visual objects, first of all, in the following way. When you see some kind of shape or color, let's say you just see some visual object, and then in your mind you think to yourself, this is a visual object, and you think to yourself that, then in a sense you are labeling it with your with a construct, you are labeling it with your imagination or with your conceptual mind. You are labeling it with conception, and then when you do that and you say to yourself, "Oh, this is a visual object. This thing here is a visual object." In a way, you're laying a construct on it, and that's the first characterization of constructs: is that you lay them on physical objects, on the very essence or the very nature of physical objects. So we're not talking about characteristics of the physical object. We're just saying that state of mind which labels the object, this is a visible object. This is an example of a visible object. And that is the first characterization. That's the first way in which constructs apply to changing things, to label their essence or to label their very nature by saying, this is a visual object. Then the second way in which constructs are applied towards changing things or things which depend on other things is that if we don't talk about conceptualizing or thinking about the very essence or the very nature of the thing, this is not the previous one that we spoke about where your mind, your conceptualizations are saying, look, this is a visual object, and when your conceptualizations are labeling it and identifying it, this is a visual object. In the second way in which conceptualization relates to physical changing objects is in the case of, and Geshe-la puts forth this thing on his bed and says, let's take this thing as a visual object. And then your mind is now saying, and you're also saying actually with your in your speech, this particular object is something that was created. This particular object is something that grew or started. This particular object is something which is changing all the time and will eventually be destroyed. And when you say that in your words, you also think it in your mind. So there's a state of mind that looks at the visual object and is thinking about it, certain characteristics or certain features of the visual object. It's thinking, this visual object was created by something. This visual object grew or started. This visual object is changing all the time. And that state of mind, conceptualizing the visual object, not in terms of its very nature or its primary identity, but rather in terms of its different features. That conceptual state of mind, that constructs by which you understand or which you label it as having different features, is the second way in which concepts or constructs apply to shenwang, things which are dependent.
Mm-hmm.
Then if you take this, you carry this same example. This example of a state of mind in which you are viewing and labeling and conceiving and conceptualizing the different features of an object. And we can go on to other features. You could say, this thing started, this thing was created, this thing is changing, which implies this thing is momentary, changing by the moment, and even that this thing exists. To think to yourself that this thing is something which exists is viewing a feature of it, is labeling it, conceiving of it with different features. And just as you understand it with a single object, if you consider a single object and then take it that way, you can go on to other objects as well. You aren't restricted to a visual object. This can apply. So any state of mind in which labels or conceives or has constructs relating to the features of an object, of a changing object, is what we call the second distinction of constructs, which relates to dependent things.
Yes.
We are 7 lines from the bottom is where the quotation begins from the sutra where the Buddha explains the intent of all his sutras. And we're going down to the last line of page 22. And it's in that chunk of sutra where Lord Buddha identifies the different features or identifies what it is to be a construct or how constructs work. The very first, we're going to jump ahead, we'll skip past the actual sutra quotation, we'll go back later and talk about it word for word, but right now we'll skip ahead and we'll think about what is the actual meaning of those three characterizations of constructs. So what are the three ways in which constructs are described? The first one is called Namrata Bichuyu, and Geshe La says if you think about it, everything in the world relating to changing things, all changing things, when we think about it, just when you think about them, in scripture it's called the object of conceptual thought. So when you think about them and you form a picture of them and you're thinking about them in a certain way and you conceptualize them, that's the first attribute or the first feature of how constructs relate to changing things. Then secondly, I'm having trouble translating, okay, but just to be frank about it. Changing things have a second quality. Now he's clarifying that these are qualities of changing things which relate to how they are constructed, okay, or how these are qualities of changing things that relate to how they are conceptualized by this constructing state of mind. So the second one would be the process of labeling. So the second feature of changing things which relates to how they are conceptualized by constructs, is that they are labeled. And they are labeled in two ways. They are the basis of the label. They are the thing which is labeled by concepts. So concepts are a state of mind, constructs are a state of mind, and they are labeling something something. So the thing that gets the label, the thing that is labeled, are changing things, shenwang. And the labeler is kundak state of mind, which is making a construct or conceptualizing that object. And the second feature of changing things that relates to constructs or the is how they are labeled. Labeled in two ways. First of all, labeled by words. Okay, so you use a word like, quote, visual object to describe a visual object in your words. And then along with the label called words comes a label called conceptualizing it a certain way. Oh, this is a visual thing. In your mind, you think about it as a visual thing. So the second feature of changing things that relates to how they are conceptualized or how they relate to constructs is that the constructing state of mind looks upon that particular object, which is called the thing which is labeled, and labels it with two different labels. One verbal almost, a word, and one mental, meaning thinking of it in a certain way. And in Tibetan, that's called that object which has the characteristic of conceptualization about it, meaning visual objects are the objects which are supplied a label in two ways by the constructing state of mind. How's that? The third feature is easy. No problem with the third feature. I said third feature of what? He says third feature of changing things. You know, I thought we were on to conceptualizations, but we're supposed to be on to conceptualizations. But anyway, constructs. Anyway, third one is easy. It's the feature in Tibetan it's called the indicators that the thing is a created thing, okay? That the thing is a composed thing, or it has been produced. I should say a produced thing, okay? So the third feature of changing things or dependent things is that they are composed. I'm sorry, no, I don't like the word composed. Produced. Okay, that they are produced by the coming together of causes and conditions. Okay, so that's the third feature of changing things. Not that's a true shagin. That's a shenwangi kichu sumo. Right now we're talking, although in general we're talking about constructs, at this moment we're only at the level of discussing changing things or dependent things and three features that they have. So the three features I just spoke about, he says, are relating to changing things. How that relates to constructs, we're going to get into right now. But we're on the subject of concepts, constructs, but right now we just had three characteristics of changing things. Now how that ties into constructs, we're going to get to right now. So we're discussing, and I have to clarify, so the first characteristic here is that looking at changing things as being the object towards which conceptualization functions. It's the first one. Second one, looking at changing things as being the thing which conceptualization labels with names and thoughts. And then thirdly, looking at changing things as being things which are characterized by being produced. Okay, so those are the three qualities of changing things. Now he says, how does that relate to conceptualization? We're discussing changing things insofar as they are the object or the basis towards which conceptualization does its thing. So it's looking at changing things and it's having concepts or making constructs in its mind. So this is whole discussion is taking off the three features of changing things that we just described all relate to constructs in the sense that we're talking about changing things as the object or the what do you call it, the arena in which constructs do their thing, in towards which the conceptual state of mind, the arena towards which it, in which it does its, in which it functions, performs its function. Now, how does that relate to constructs? How do those three features of changing things relate to constructs? The whole point is that there are three elements here. There's shenwang, which is changing objects, which are the arena in which the constructing or the conceptual state of mind is doing its thing. And then there's the conceptual state of mind, which is acting towards that arena or acting in that arena of changing things. But then there's a third element, isn't there? You know, when you look at a visual object and you think in your mind, this is something to see, I'm seeing something. And the minute you start thinking that, you form a mental image. He says it's a lot like the dunji idea we have in the other schools, is where there's a dopa dunji, means that construct which the conceptual state of mind makes up or creates after focusing, after working in the arena of changing things. So it focuses towards changing things as the arena of its function. And then it's a state of mind which is looking there, and it's a state of mind which is thinking to itself, oh, hey, this is a visual thing. And the minute it starts doing that, there becomes a third element in between the two, which is a mental image of which it has made up. It's a construct of a visual thing, you know. So actually, it's starting to look at this construct of visual thing rather than the thing in the arena in which it's doing its thing. And that is constructs. That is the first group. Those things, that third element in between the constructing state of mind and the arena in which it acts, that in between there are all those constructs or mental images that the mind is making up and ends up focusing on. And those are kundaka. And that's how constructs relates to changing things, the features of changing things. This single point that we just described is going to be the biggest hassle for, you know, this whole discussion. That last few sentences that we did is going to be the whole problem. With the whole following section, we got to tear that apart, rip it apart. We have to clean it up in a sense. So what we've done so far is to drive a huge bulldozer into a forest and knock down a few trees, and they made a big mess. There's not like a clear plot of land right now. We just had a bunch of knocked down, smashed up trees, and now we got to clear. Now we got to do cleanup. We just got the main idea was just presented, but now there's a lot of cleaning up to do before we have the final
product. Mm-hmm.
I think we can clean up. I think we can. What is it called? There's a word in English. We can. There's a word in English. Make something more subtle or clean or. We could polish it. Yeah, we could polish this idea with an illustration, because right now all you've got is the arena in which the mind is acting, right, which is changing things, and then it's having some kind of a construct about it, which is very, very similar to the idea of a dunchi, a mental image, but it's not quite what you call a dunchi. Okay, so we gotta work it out a little bit. We have to polish this concept. You know, I brought up mental images, but it's a little bit more than just a simple mental image. So what you've got so far is this arena in which the conceptual state of mind is acting. You have the conceptual state of mind, and then you have something that is creating, some kind of construct that is creating. So it's a difference between a construct and a mental image. We have to talk about it. And then we're going to try to use, in order to polish up these concepts or make them more refined, I was looking for the word refined. In order to refine these ideas, we're going to go to an illustration. We're going to use some kind of illustration in order to refine what we've spoken about so far. And I hope we can refine it. Give you an illustration. So a man and a woman have a child. And the child is, you know, the woman's pregnant for a while, and then she has the baby, and right, you know, the second after the baby comes out, the baby's there. So there's a baby there. And then maybe a day later or two, we don't go around naming the baby. They don't come out in the hospital, pop out, and immediately you say, oh, this is the baby's name. You know what I mean? In Tibet, I don't know how it is in America, but they wait a day or two, and all the excitement's over, and then they think about, what are we going to name this child? And then they name the child. And only on the second day or the first or second day afterwards, the father, who's normally the person who names the child, is looking at the child and saying, oh, we'll call this child Dashi. Okay, so we'll call this child Dashi. And only after that moment does everyone and the parents start conceptualizing or thinking of the child as Dashi. This is my child Dashi. This is my boy Dashi. Only after that naming process, only after the father has actually labeled the child, oh, this is Dashi, does everyone start having the conceptual state of mind that says, oh, now we have a kid. Now we have a kid named Dashi. Okay, now we have a child named Dashi. And even though they had a child the moment the baby came out of the womb, the moment the baby was born, they had a child. But now they kind of think more, you know, now I have a child named Dashi. You know, now I have this boy. Here's my boy, Dashi, you know. So it's only after the fact, in a sense, after the labeling has occurred, that they are saying to themselves, oh, now I have a boy named Dashi. So, what do you guys think, okay? When we talk about the thing that got the name Dashi, the object which was given the name Dashi. Did that object which was given the name Dashi exist right after the thing was born? Or did the object which was given the name Dashi exist only upon the naming of the thing as Dashi? So, when did the object named Dashi exist? Was it right after something was born? Or was it right after they decided to give it the name Dashi. Kashi ge kema ta du pugu dashi se ni yore. Kashi ge dashi ki ming ta tsane da dashi se ge shi di dup shas. Kashi ge kema ta du dashi se ge ming di ge shi dup tsane.
Shi di kashi dashi re. Dashi du sa yi. Dashi yi shi se ne ke ta la sa yi shi di re. Sam ge re. Ami kuban kema ta ga la sa mi sun da ji pugu ton de ta ya di. Dashi si sa yi pugu di re. Sam ge re sam ge ma.
Ane ane kema ta du. Okay, let's. He's going to change the question a little bit, or maybe I didn't, or maybe I didn't translate it very well. But anyway, he says, just after the kid is born, and before he's named Tashi, do people stand there and say, "Oh, Tashi's born"? You know?
No.
Did I change my name? This is tough. So the object which is named with the name Dashi, although there was an object that existed right after the child was born, you don't call it the object which is named Dashi until the labeling, until he's actually called Dashi. So only upon calling him Dashi is there a thing that we can say, oh, this is the thing they call Dashi. And after that time, when there's that thought, oh, my boy is named Dashi, okay, and the idea of Dashi, when does that occur? And what is that like? And isn't it just sort of a construct existing between the object which is named Dashi and the father who's naming him Dashi? And then there's the idea of a boy named Dashi, okay? So do you see these kind of three elements? One is something which is getting the name. There's a child, there's a baby who's being called Dashi. That's the arena. Then there's the state of mind or the father actually saying, I'm going to name my boy Dashi now. And then there's this sort of a thing in the middle, isn't there, called the boy named Dashi. The thing which is the boy named Dashi is almost like a construct or an idea that's existing between the baby which got the name Dashi, the father who's naming him Dashi, and then there's this thing in the middle, isn't there? Nothing. That did gili, that did basili, dashi se agi chinyones. So you got it? You got that thing in the middle? So you got it? You got the idea of this thing in between? You got this idea of the thing in between? Something which is not the state of mind which is naming it Dashi. Something which is not the baby which got the name Dashi, but something in between. Something like the baby with the name Dashi applied to it, and now this object called the baby named Dashi. So you got this third thing in the middle. Got that? Comfortable with that? Yes. You got it? Do you agree that there is a thing between there? You got to make some kind of... Yeah. So if you want to find something in the world that you can call, this is what we call a construct. This is what we call a kundak. That's it. That's that second one. That's that one in the middle. So, question and give answer, okay? I mean, this is, you gotta wake up. Does this thing in the middle exist? Is it an existent thing or a non-existent thing? So you can call this a construct which is an existing thing. That seems to be implying something else, okay? Oh. This is what we call a construct which is an existing thing.
Oh,
So again, consider the one in the middle, okay? Consider the construct called Tashi the boy, which is Tashi the boy. Just after the child was born, and there was a child there, and before the father had this idea, right? It was the father who had the first idea, right? The father first, it first occurs to this person. The father is the first one that it occurs to call this baby Tashi, and that's only like a day or two later, okay? So consider that process, and just before that process, or before, there did come a child out of the womb. There was a child there. There was some kind of basis there. At that moment, when the child first came out of the womb, was there a construct called Tashi the child? That came out to the killer day in the Yomanes.
Oh, my lord, you that I eat that looks then you ask. Copu Coranda Yam to Trumason
asked.
Matuba in the deed, Tashi, the key del Denian call. You rangi deluji, tomorrow may be deluji wanted to be our mind.
Oh, that's nice. So if you think about it, the construct didn't pop into existence when the kid was born. It's not like something that popped into existence with the bearing of the child. Okay, it's not like the child was born and the second the child was born, the construct pops up. Okay, that now here's the cool part. That's an indication that construct is not one of those things which exist from its own side through its own unique nature. Remember we talked about that? So that's an indication of what it means when you say that this thing doesn't have a nature of existing from its own side through its own unique way of being. If you want to know what that particular phrase means, you just got it. Okay? It's that it didn't pop up simultaneously, linked along with the child when the child was born. And that's an indication that it doesn't fit that description of something which is existing from its own side through its own unique way of being. This is really beautiful. So the question of whether this thing has come into being or not, the middle one, right? The construct. The question of whether it has come into being or not. The question of whether it exists or not, the thing which imparts to it its existence, the thing which lends it its very existence, can we say that it's the state of mind of the father that's lending it or giving it its existence? Or do we say that it has some kind of unique existence of its own coming from its own side? Which one is it? Is it the that the tobe digi kurangi yobasogi yores? And that's what it. And because it's the father's conceptual state of mind which lends it its existence, that's what it means when we say, very very famous in Buddhist philosophy, simply a product of the a construct of the mind, simply a projection. We say in the other classes, simply a product of the mind, and that's what it means when we say something is simply a product of mind, which is, by the way, always. Opposed or opposed to the idea of existing from its own side with its own unique nature. Okay? So this is the opposite of that, which is simply a product of the mind, simply a projection of the mind. And so we've established, haven't we, that this thing in the middle, the construct, is something which is simply a projection or simply a construct of the mind. Simply a construct of the mind. Simply a construct of your conceptualization. Okay? And we can say, therefore, that it's not like this other thing which has from its own side, right? From its own unique way of being from its own side, okay? And that's what it means in this school when we say that this thing in the middle does not exist by definition. Does not exist by definition. There you go. That's exactly what it means.
That is
it. Got it? Got it? Say something. You gotta say something. Good. Be careful not to slip into the mind of Mikador, okay, and catch the following thing. The mind-only school says that's what it means when we say that this thing in the middle doesn't exist by definition. There you go. Okay? In the mind-only school, that's what it means when we say that something doesn't exist by definition. Now you've got that feeling. Totally different from Madhyamika. Don't go into the Madhyamika door. Don't let yourself slip into Madhyamika. In the mind-only school, that's exactly what we, just how we've described the middle one, is exactly what we mean when we say that thing doesn't have a nature of existing by definition. Okay? So if you think about it, there is no such thing as the middle thing which could exist from its own side with its own unique nature, right? No such thing is possible. But if there were such a thing as the thing in the middle which was existing from its own side with its own unique way of being, that would be the ultimate gakcha. That would be the ultimate thing which we deny when we talk of emptiness in the mind-only school. And that's what would be. If such a thing existed, then that would be the such an existence is what we deny when we say emptiness in the mind-only school. So there you've got, that is what we call the self-nature of objects, which is the ultimate object denied when we speak of emptiness in the mind-only school. Don't slip off into Manyamika, please. Okay. Got it? Because it be nema jinden biti na umma mamu tiyo na the big gawa tiyo do din dab sem yabu segi do.
What do you say? Tanko megi thanda rangi tengi chuba ko sto kala meti ko rangi tengi chuba iye rangi tengi chuba ko yotta yawa mar tengo kunda ji ko shao ha dena ya kunda ji ko shao.
Oh boy. The theoretical thing of the thing in the middle which existed from its own side through its own unique nature, which would mean a thing in the middle which existed by definition, is another kind of kuntan. Right? It's another kind of construct. The imagination of such a thing, the mental picture of such a thing, which is impossible, right? The mental picture of an impossible thing, of a thing which was a construct and which existed through its own unique way of being from its own side, and therefore existed by definition, that in itself is a construct, isn't it? So now we got a second kind of kundar, don't we? A second kind of construct. And that's the kind that doesn't exist. That's a construct which doesn't exist. So there's two kinds of constructs, right? One which does exist, and one which doesn't exist, even with regard to the one in the middle. How do you feel, Guy?
It seems like the thing that it's referring to doesn't exist, but the kind.
It's not the same construct. He was checking out your communicating form. Oh boy. Now we're getting into more detail on how changing things are acting as the arena or the basis in which we have all these ideas, okay? So, the fact that with regard to visual objects or changing things, we cannot say of them that our construct of them is something which comes from its own side and its own unique way of being, or which exists by definition. The fact that this one doesn't exist with regard to this is the totality of this, meaning the emptiness of this. Got it? So the fact that the self-existent construct doesn't exist with regard, that this thing doesn't have a corresponding self-existent concept about it, is its emptiness. That in itself, according to the mind-only school, is Yongdu, is what we call totality, is the third group in the mind-only school. Got it? So the fact that this thing, when you consider it as a thing that came from its, if you say, this, imagine a number two, a concept which came from its own side, had its own unique way of being, was not just something made up in my mind, which doesn't exist, right? That thing's impossible. The impossibility of that thing with regard to this thing is this thing's emptiness. Okay, that is the Yongdrup, or the third category of this thing. And that's how Shenwangs are so useful for getting the other two categories. See? Okay? That's how they act as the arena for describing the other two groups. Okay? So let's take another example. I got here a stick in my hand, stick of wood, okay? And can we, now perk up and give me some ideas here, okay? Can we characterize this in three different ways, given the conversation we just had? Show me these three characteristics that this, the three features now of this thing. Give me three features of this thing.
It depends on causes.
Rangi Gyugyenle Kemen, yes? You got them backwards. Can you give them to me straight? The cat is climbing down a ladder. Cats never go, you know, like cats go the wrong way. wrong order. But it's okay. We don't need any order here.
Okay.
Huh? Don't forget these three, we have these three characteristics. It's the arena. No, it's different thing. Maybe we start out with three characters. He wants Chilt to try.
Okay. It's the object towards which the conceptualized.
Is that in the arena in which conceptualization is acting, is functioning? Yeah. So it fits the first feature, what we call the first feature. So forget the one in the middle. We're talking about the third one now. Right? We're talking about the third one, the baby, before it got named Tashi. Not the concept, we're talking about the baby. Three features of the baby. First of all, it is the arena in which conceptualization is acting. Okay, second one is Kundakitsini kine.
It's the thing which it holds on to. It's the
no, remember we had two labels. This is the labeling process, right? The second feature.
Yeah, I didn't quite see how that.
Nipa did it. It fits the second feature's description, because isn't it that thing which we name with the name bamboo stick or stick of bamboo, and isn't it the thing which we conceptualize as a bamboo, which we label with the thought or with the picture? This is a bamboo shing. So I'm not too good in English. You want to call it back scratching, whatever you call it. I don't know anything about it. But it is a stick. I'm calling it a stick. I have a word in verbally. I am naming it a bamboo stick. mentally, I'm labeling it as a bamboo stick, and that's how it fits the second feature, in which being the arena or being the object, which is labeled, okay, by concepts. Now, the third one is easy. I mean, of course it has a third feature, which is it came from its causes and conditions. So those are the three features. First one was what? It's the arena in which conceptual mind works. Secondly, it is that object which receives the label of the mind and the word. And thirdly, it is something which has grown from its causes and conditions. So it fits the three features of a changing thing, of a dependent thing. So now, having finished that, okay, we finished the three features. We got the stick, we got the state of mind which is calling it, oh, hey, here's a stick, you know, we got a stick here. We got a state of mind that's doing that. But during that process, there's a stick out here, there's a state of mind that's saying, hey, there's a stick here. Doesn't something, third thing, start forming in the middle, which is the mental image of a stick, and your mind is starting to produce some kind of construct or some kind of conceptualization called a stick, and then your mind is starting to focus on this conceptualization. When it says, oh, stick, 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 there's stick, you know, and then there begins a conceptualization in the middle, doesn't there?
Yeah.
So you got this stick, don't you, that the object in which your conceptualizations are, the arena in which your conceptualizations are working, then you have the conceptual state of mind, and as you start focusing on it and thinking, here's a stick, 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 and then you get this thing forming in the middle, which is a concept, a construct, which is of a stick, and then when you think about that, that construct is, isn't it, it's kind of being, it's depending, or it's relating to the Shenwang, isn't it? The here is a thing which is dependent on its causes, which has been produced by its causes, and here in the middle is a thing called constructs, the first of the three groups, right? So here in the middle is a thing called constructs is starting to form. And if you think about it, there's a construct which really does exist, which is the just a kind of a mental construct of the stick, the mental construct you have in your mind of the stick. But if you think about it carefully, there's another construct which doesn't exist, which is the theoretical, impossible one of thinking of this construct as being something which is existing from its own side through its own unique nature, and not just as a product of my conceptualization. And the lack, or the absence, or the non-applicability of that to the basis, which is the wood or the shenwang, is its yongdu. Is its emptiness, is its what we call totality, which is the third group. So you got all three groups covered in just this one process. Is it clear in your skulls or not? Got it? Got it? Did everybody get it? Did everybody get all of it? Did you get all of it? He's using the word for clear, polished. Is it polished? I think, you know, he's referring back. If you want to right now make yourself some heavy duty notes so you don't forget what just happened, better do it now. If you've got it mentally okay, you can go home and write it there. Okay, if it's pretty firm in your mind, then go when you get home, write it down. But otherwise, you better do it right now. We've taken a specific case. We've taken a specific analysis of this case. We took the stick, right? We took the baby, then we took the stick. And the stick is a specific example for this process that I've described to you. Now take that process. Now take that reasoning. And you can just apply it to all the other objects in the universe. You can go ahead, every other changing thing, every other functional thing. You can go ahead and take this same logic, the same thinking, all of the components of the same thinking, and go latch on to any other existing functional object, changing thing, and you can apply it exactly to that as well. Got it? It's okay?
Yes.
Okay. If you don't make a noise, I don't know if you got it or not. So what do you think? Did I say is to be taken figurative or literally?
Just kidding.
I think he's referring to when he asked you to say something, you seem to be taking it as figurative. A crucial point here, very, very crucial point. You know, it's not so much this one and it's not so much this point. It's the one in the middle. The very, very crucial, everything pivots, everything turns on the one in the middle. Do you understand? Do you grasp it when I say that there's a version of it which exists, and there's a version of it which doesn't exist? Got it?
Okay.
When you focus on this second one in the middle, and somebody says to you, does this exist by definition according to the mind-only school? You'll keep saying, oh, no, scripture says, book says, Jesukapa says, no, doesn't exist by definition. I read it many times. Yeah, I got it. It says, Rangitinikimadubha, it doesn't exist by definition. But to really understand what that means, to in your own mind, to have a very clear picture of what the mind-only school means when they say that one in the middle doesn't exist by definition is very difficult. And why it is that there's a new word he's introducing, which is from perceptual theory, which is the thing we think we see. The thing we think we see, okay? That thing which you think you see, which is some kind of self-existent to it, or some kind of existence by definition, to understand why that's not there, to clearly understand why this thing doesn't exist by definition, is extremely difficult. It's not as easy as saying, oh yeah, the book says, the one in the middle doesn't exist by definition. That's easy. But to really clearly grasp why the one in the middle doesn't exist by definition is difficult. But if you get it, if you ever get to a point where you get it clearly in your mind, intellectually you understand clearly why number two in this mind-only school doesn't exist by definition, then, says Geshe La, you really have grasped the essential points of the mind-only school. That is the essential point of the mind-only school. If you can understand or explain clearly to somebody why the one in the middle doesn't exist by definition, then you've really grasped the whole essence of the mind-only school.
Sujin pena ngara du ma che gi nam ga se ra na da
So when you think about when you talk about this one in the middle, right, the one in the middle, and you're also talking about kuntak or constructs in the sense of unchanging things, kick out emptiness, right, and all the other unchanging things in the world which are supposed to be constructs, right? Remember how we described the group in the beginning? We said constructs is all the unchanging things in the world after you kick out emptiness itself, okay? So you go off of all those unchanging things that we always talk about, you know? We're always standing around talking about unchanging things. We go thinking about unproduced things, and we're talking about empty space, and then maybe we talk about, there's an idea that there's the unchanging thing of the mental image itself, general mental images, being unchanging things. We go off and talk about other kinds of unchanging things, okay? But then, with regard to this single bamboo stick, the middle thing in the middle, the kuntak, the construct, okay? How do you feel about, like, what is the, is there a distinction between all those general unchanging things, like empty space? You know, I'm not talking about emptiness, okay? But empty space, for example, place, empty space. How do you think, you know, here you've got one little tiny unchanging thing. You've got something, you've got one little tiny example of a construct. The specific example that relates to this specific stick that we're talking about. Is there a distinction between between this and all those other ones with regard to their unchangingness? Is there some kind of key here that distinguishes those from this one? Mark for something you want to give us later, you just pulled it out. When he said, is there a distinction between the one in the middle and all those other unchanging things we talk about, he says, I was not talking about whether it was unchanging or not. Okay, I wasn't talking about whether there was any difference in the way they are unchanging or not. That's not what I was getting at. That's not what I wanted to get to. It was this. When you're trying to establish the totality, right, which means emptiness of this thing, when you're trying to establish the emptiness of this stick, right, and you think of it in terms of the construct being a thing which exists by definition, right, and the fact that the construct doesn't exist by definition being the emptiness of the stick, well, then does this example of an unchanging thing called the construct of the stick, is that more useful for you in establishing the emptiness, and especially the emptiness of the stick, than thinking about all those other unchanging things like empty space and things like that?
Yes.
So, so this clears up an incredible point. You see, it's not so useful for understanding totality or emptiness when you're just thinking about general kuntaks, right? General non-changing things, general like empty space or something like that, which is, you know, the book said a long time ago that unchanging things were examples of constructs, you know, and that constructs were unchanging things. After you talk about kick out emptiness, and you know, the Buddha could have just sat there on that point and said, that's enough, you know, I told you, constructs are unchanging, and unchanging things are constructs, except for emptiness, right? And we could have left it at that. Why did we drag in changing things? Why are we talking about changing things being the arena in which we examine the concept of constructs? There you go. Because it's a lot easier to understand emptiness if you take a changing thing as the arena in which you explore the idea of a construct. So then, by taking changing things as the arena in which you explore the idea of a construct, you can come to a very easily to an understanding of their emptiness. So if you just go around being satisfied with explaining, oh, you know, constructs are unchanging things, empty space is an unchanging thing, empty space is a construct, that doesn't help you so much in establishing the meaning of totality or emptiness. But if you take as your arena all changing things, and then you examine them in this way, with regard to this construct, the existing version and the non-existing version of this construct, then you come to this very subtle and very beautiful understanding of emptiness, which you never could have had if you didn't take shenwangs or dependent things as the arena in which we're going to discuss constructs. Ooh, that's nice. That's very cool. If you're going to write something down, you better do it now. You might forget it. You know, why did we bring in shenwang? You know? That's a very important point. I hope somebody's taking good notes. I don't have time. That was the whole problem we started today. Is I didn't know what the heck he was talking about. Shenwang? He was talking about kuntak. You know, why is he bringing in shenwang?
Gunda kangi tomba yondu sida yondu kore. Yondu to jok to cups of koi gunda, jingeva to go with gunda. Yondu get a shape with a koi gunda.
Koa, like
good, 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 good,
good, good, good, We also distinguish another, we distinguish the two kinds of, remember we talked about two kinds of kuntaks, two kinds of constructs. He says, you know, in Tibetan we have a much more beautiful expression to refer to the two kinds of constructs. You know, you can call, the first one could be the one that is a, koa in Tibetan means a necessary accoutrement, okay? A necessary accoutrement for understanding the emptiness of the stick. You see? The one that you have to be thinking about to understand the emptiness of the stick. And then there's those other ones, like, you know, general kuntaks, like empty space and all those other ones, you know, all those other general unchanging things, which are not necessary accoutrement for understanding the emptiness of the stick. But here, these ones, we can divide constructs in a different way, right? Rather than saying the ones that exist and the ones that don't exist, there's the ones that you have to focus on in order, which are necessary, which are a necessity or a prerequisite for understanding the emptiness of the stick. And then there's all those other ones that are not such a prerequisite for understanding the emptiness of something. Two kinds of constructs.
What
And again, Geshe Thubten wants to go back to the scriptural authority, so you don't know, he just made up that whole last presentation, and he wants to tie it down, link it to an actual part of the text. He says, we'll go back to the, don't forget, we'll go back to where we were on page 23 later, but I want to jump ahead to page 25, second line, and this is the scriptural reference which backs up what I just said. The text says, we are not going to now treat the other kinds of constructs. We are going to concentrate on the kinds of constructs which are the one in the middle. Okay, so here in the text itself, it says we are not in the process of identifying what constructs are. We are going to focus on this specific kind of construct, and we're not going to talk about constructs in general. We're going to use this one, which relates to establishing that other important thing. Okay. This is Jetson Kaba's own wording for that concept. And he says here at the end of those lines, we'll get into this more later. You know, I'm going to explain to you now. I'm sorry, I should have said, I'm going to explain to you now through this method what it means to be a construct. How to identify what constructs are. When Jetson Kapa says here, I'm going to explain to you the constructs in this light, okay, in this particular light, he does so much further on. And Geshe Thubten wants to show you where, because not sure we'll ever get that far in this particular series of classes, so we better jump there now. Page 85. Okay, just going down to page 85. Seventh line. Here is the direct quotation by Jetson Kapa, and here's how it goes. We are on page 85. We are on the seventh line from the top, and it says, generally speaking, there are kinds of constructs, other kinds of constructs. For example, all chitsens. Chitsens are like... in general, there are different kinds of... This is very difficult, but in logic, there are things like Jungian... What do they call them?
Archetypes.
It's a thing called like an archetype, okay? As opposed to the thing which the archetype refers to, the actual object. And that's called chitsen and nangsen. So he says all those things which are called archetypes in some schools, and all those things like empty space and other kinds of unchanging things. These are unchanging things. There are many, many different kinds, but the sutra in which the Buddha explains the intent of his sutras, which is the main sutra which the Manoi school uses, right, to back up their school, that one doesn't mention those. It doesn't talk about those. What does it talk about? Why doesn't it talk about them? It doesn't talk about them because those kinds of constructs are not the ones which are necessary accoutrements for understanding totality, meaning emptiness. And there's where, that's the later that comes on page 25, 60 pages later, you get the later, where Jetson Kapa says, this is why Lord Buddha in that particular sutra doesn't mention all those other ones when he talks about constructs. He goes straight for the ones that are necessary, kutumo, for understanding the idea of totality or emptiness.
Okay.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Do you want detail or not? I said, sure. You guys are the jet set generation, and back in Tibet, we didn't have any cars, we didn't have any railroad, we didn't have anything. We just plodded along in our own pace. It's okay if we go through the book like that? Yeah. Did that this. Gemma get and gemma go to this. Get and gemma go to this. That Kalega didn't do this.
China, that is the number of Shirachi, the number of Yaga Yotros.
I don't know. Maybe airplanes better. What do you think? Geshe and gemma go to this. Geshe and gemma go to this. Just kidding.
Oh, dear. That then a Gunda knew you must take you again Gunda Chigna. Again Gunda Jara.
The
그다음에
Okay. When you talk about the one in the middle, okay? Remember there's the one that exists and remember there's the one that doesn't exist, right? The non-self-existent one and the self-existent one, right? The one that exists by definition, the one that doesn't exist by definition. Did I get that right? No. Oh, sorry, which doesn't exist by definition and does exist by definition. That's better, right? So this one, as opposed to all those other kinds of constructs like empty space and all that, is required or is a necessary kutuma in two senses. Okay? Necessary kutuma in two senses. First of all, it's the positive one, the one that does exist. Okay? The one which is like really there between the mind that's thinking of the stick and the stick itself. The one in which the mind conceptualizes stick. That picture, stick, right? That construct, stick. That one is needed for the stick in the sense of the stick being the object which is empty. Okay? So we call it in Tibetan the construct between the stick and the mind perceiving the stick which is necessary for the thing which is empty. Okay? All right? It's a necessary accoutrement of the thing which is empty. Okay? So in establishing the emptiness of the stick, you're not only going to talk about the construct which doesn't exist, you're going to talk about the construct which does exist. The construct which does exist still stays in the category of necessary accoutrement for establishing the emptiness of the stick, because it's a necessary accoutrement for the thing which is going to be proven to be empty, which is the stick. Okay? So in that sense, it's still a necessary accoutrement for understanding the emptiness of the stick, because it's a necessary accoutrement for the basis or the thing which is empty, which is the stick itself. Okay? The stick considered from the point of view of being the basis, or the thing which is empty, has to have a necessary accoutrement of the construct with which we perceive it. Okay, so that's a necessary accoutrement for that sense. Then there's the other version of the construct, which is the one that doesn't exist. Okay, a construct which could come from its own sign, a construct which could exist by definition, which doesn't exist, right? That one is a necessary accoutrement for establishing the gakcha. You see? That one is a necessary accoutrement for establishing what it is that we deny to reach the emptiness of the stick. Okay? So that's a necessary component or element in understanding what it is that we deny when we speak of emptiness. So in two senses, each one of the two versions or the two flavors of this construct, the one that does exist and the one doesn't exist, are both necessary accoutrements for understanding the emptiness of the state. Okay, got it? That's really cool. Okay.
What it is?
Now we're shifting back into the very first mode we came to this class with. If you think about everything we've said so far, we've been talking about a state of mind which is focusing on the stick and saying to itself, this is a stick, that has the mental picture of a stick, right? It's been focusing on the very nature, or the very identity, or the very stick as a whole, right? But what about a state of mind? Can we apply all this logic, can we apply all this reasoning to that second mode, right, that we talked about at the very beginning, which I mistook for the three features, right? We never got to the third one. You'll catch it later in the tape. There's a state of mind which says, oh, the stick is impermanent, the stick is changing, the stick is something that was made, the stick is something that was produced, which is focusing upon characteristics or features of the stick. Can you apply all that we said so far today to the state of mind which is saying about the stick, oh, you know the stick is impermanent, you know this stick was produced, you know this stick started at some point? Can you apply everything that we've said to that state of mind as well? This is very, very important, because this is a very, very difficult phrase in Tibetan when you study Chang'e, which is very, very difficult phrase to translate. Means the state of mind which is creating a construct, the constructing state of mind which is creating a construct with regard to a feature of its object. Okay? The constructing state of mind which is creating a construct with regard to a feature of the stick, meaning the sticks, the fact that the stick grew, the fact that the stick is changing, okay? As opposed to focusing on the stick itself as an object, okay? Now it's focusing on certain characteristics or features of the stick, and that's called in Tibetan, very difficult phrase, the constructive state of mind that's creating a construct about the features of the stick. And that, you know, used to drive me crazy trying to translate that. Now you've got it. Now you've got, when you talk about all three elements with regard to perceiving the feature of the stick, that's what you're talking about. Okay, question for you guys. Wake up. Forget all those other kinds of constructs. Not talking about empty space, not talking about archetypes, not talking about anything like that. We are just talking about this one in the middle, with the stick, okay? Restricting ourselves to this particular construct. Forget the divisions I made, or I want you, yourselves, to think carefully over. If we had to make a very basic, elementary, initial division of these kinds of constructs into two, you know, for example, in the way that we take all existing objects and split them into changing things and unchanging things, could you guys think up a way of taking these constructs, these particular constructs that are staying in the middle here, and dividing them into two or three broad groupings? Can you guys come up with one?
Is it just the existing category that we're dividing?
Yugyu kundari sigyore, yugyu de megyu
nyamdu sigyore.
Good question, and you can consider them as we want to know both. The ones that exist and the ones that don't exist. So you can take the ones that don't, you can also throw in the ones that don't exist and give me a division of those two together.
Yeah,
So just with regard to the constructs that relate to a back scratcher stick, okay, restrict yourself to the constructs that relate to a back scratcher stick. I want you to consider that like all of Sera Monastery, the whole Sera, the population of Sera Monastery. And then you grab all these guys and you say, you're members of Sera J, and you grab all these guys and say, you're members of Sera Mey, and you come up with two great groupings. Can you come up with one? How many groupings are you going to, how many are going to be in your group? Are there going to be two, three, four? Yes. Let's hear what they are.
The object itself, the nampa tope chiyu, and the characteristics of the object.
Shinging o la jagyu kundatan shingi keba la jagyu kundanis.
Labeling the object as a physical thing and labeling it as
features.
The features of
it. Shinging o la jarwe kundatan shingi keba la jarwe kundanis yinas. Are you their legally elected representative, or would the people like to talk?
Like the progesterone and the stick, right?
Say again?
Like what she just said is the one that's produced, you know, like there's stick,
uh-huh.
And then the one that's changing, the like there's a the thing that's changing, then you're like changing object, you know? Like,
do samlotana kundati mitap kunda korana mitapres. That's a difficult. Kundaks don't change. Kuntape lo de mitaparwa. Ani kunda damanda shayongres. Kunda dinji sorry damanda shayongres. Dinji korana gyogi chigitus. Ketching machigi kunda de da gyungi. I think he's saying, look, everything has their own constructs, right? And there are lots of different constructs. But with regard, I think what he's trying to say is that with regard to one object's constructs at a certain given moment, and not talking about how the different constructs might arise as different constructing minds arise. Just at any given, I think what he wants to say is at any given moment, the construct of any given moment, which doesn't change, you see, can you give me divisions of that one?
I think I'd follow Christian say the thing which is the basis of having features, and then the features about the thing that is the
shirgyupe chichengi. Chichengi kunda te dan digi kechegi kunda nisu yena kande dos.
Ta ane ga chi ni ta ku kwa ta de losun de la kyan di kwa la ti ju ba chi tuen na
ne. Ju ba chi tuen ne. Gui ni ane ni kwa la kame na. He wants to make sure that your point was addressed to your satisfaction, because he sees you kind of looking like that, you know.
Well, yeah. What did he said? Say it again. What he said.
He's talking about the construct of the whole piece of wood, you know, when you say wood,
right,
and then the construct of when you focus on wood and say the wood is impermanent, or the wood is changing, or the wood is breaking, or something like that.
Right.
Is that what you meant to say? Oh, I love a dagger on this. In a several love men, I am that Korangi love a chip press. The pena a shingi moldang. Shingi mitapalas ding in love. So it wasn't the case that you meant to say that the mental construct of a piece of wood, or the mental construct of the piece of wood as a changing thing, was itself changing all the time. You didn't mean to say that. Oh, di mitapalas ng alam mes. Okay, that's the one. Yeah. So you're both in the same chikpa chawri, koni chin chawri.
That's the one.
He says he likes it when somebody has a problem with something he said and is doubting, is trying to figure it out, is obviously having a question about it, and is obviously trying to work something out that they don't get, that maybe the other people, because it's not like I can hand out paychecks to everybody and refuse you a paycheck. You have to, you know, you have a just as much, you should in fact raise your questions and chase your question until it's resolved. And I much prefer that in my classes than people are sitting there, you know, like that, and not bringing up any issues at all. I love issues, and I love people who bring up the issues. And in my class, I want people bringing up issues rather than sitting there, okay. Lots of us. The whole point of a class is to go from a state of not understanding to a state of understanding. And there's another state in which people sit, which is repeating like parrots what I say and not really understanding it. And since the whole point of the class is to go from a state of not understanding to a state of understanding, and since exchange is required for that, you know, going back and forth on an issue until the issue is resolved is required for that, I like issues and I like resolving issues, and we just resolved an issue. So you both are right. In fact, you're all three right when you say that there are two kinds of constructs, if you think about it. There's a construct which is constructed with regard to the central and the main nature or main identity of an object, and then there's a construct which is constructed with regard to the features of that object, and you got it. With regard only to this back scratcher stick, this piece of bamboo, and with regard now, we are restricting ourselves to the construct which is being constructed with regard to its main identity, not to its features. How many of those? Remember we divided them into constructs which are constructed with regard to the main thing. And then we talked about constructs which are constructed with regard to the features of the thing. Now forget the second one, just the first one. Constructs which are constructed with regard to the main thing. How many of those are there? How many divisions are you going to give me on those? Don't forget, you're three. Who's that number? Who said two? Let's hear the two. Give them a name, you know. You got an abbot, you got to name the abbot.
There's the construct that you construct that doesn't really exist, and there's the doctor, the construct where you think the thing exists for its own self.
Okay, we got your two. We want to hear the three that this one brought up here. If she's already covered two of yours, you could just throw in the third. let's forget it. It's two. Exactly that. The one which exists and the one which doesn't exist. The one which does exist, okay, in this case, with this example, is the one which is a necessary accoutrement of the object which is going to be proven to be empty. The object which is said to be empty, which is the stick itself. And then the one which doesn't exist, okay, the construct which doesn't exist, is going to be the one which is said to be a necessary accoutrement of the gakcha, or which is necessary for establishing the gacha, the thing which emptiness is empty of. So you guys can figure out easily that this same divisions can be carried on to the constructs which relate to the features of the object, right? The same two divisions that we just mentioned can be applied to the constructs which relate to the features of the object. So we go through the whole process, which is very hard for me to remember when he's going through it. We go through the whole process with the kid, right? Let's go back to the kid. Remember the kid and the whole process of naming the kid. So there is a construct which relates to the kid. During the naming of the kid, there has arisen a construct named Tashi the kid, right? The kid named Tashi. That construct has arisen. It is only something that is a projection, or it is only something which is a construct of the mind. But that's not to say it doesn't exist, okay? It does exist. The construct does exist, okay? And then with regard to this construct, we can say that the fact that we can say of this construct that it's not something which exists from its own side with its own unique nature. And but there's something else about it. He said, this construct is only something which is a construct of the mind first, okay? And the fact that it's, and then the second step is that it is not something that comes from its own side in its, with its own unique nature. And in this example, what we said was, it was not something that came along with that kid the minute he was born out of the womb, okay? That middle thing, the construct, was not something that popped out when the kid popped out of the womb. Okay, so the construct is, that's a sign that the construct is not something which is coming from its own side with its own unique nature. That's an indication that it really is just something that is a construct of our mind, because it only happened later when the daddy said, oh, now I'm going to name this boy Tashi. So the construct, in being something that did not pop out of the womb along with the baby, is therefore not something which comes from its own side through its own unique way of being. That's a sign that it doesn't come from its own side with its own unique way of being. And that's an indication that it is only a construct of the mind, the fact that it didn't come along with the baby from the first moment. And that's an indication, or that's what it means when we say that that thing doesn't exist by definition. That's what it means when we say that that thing doesn't exist by definition. And the fact that that doesn't exist, the fact that a construct which does exist by definition is something that could never apply to the boy, is the yongdu, or the totality, or the emptiness of the boy. Okay? The fact that there could never be a concept which did exist by definition, or which did come from its own unique way of being, which applied to the boy, is the very emptiness, or the what we call totality in the mind-only school, of the boy. And there you go, you got all three of those groups of the mind-only school. Cool. If you think about it, I've now described that process with the same object like three times. Now there's a thing in Buddhist writing called the fault of repeating yourself too much, okay? What's it called? There's a word in English. Redundancy, okay? So he says, you know, you might think I'm getting into that compositional fault called redundancy. Not the point. I'm just trying to get it clear in your mind, so don't think I'm being redundant, okay? We've been through it with the same object about three times. I hope you're not saying thank you for being redundant. We started out this class running that bulldozer through the forest. We had all these tree trunks laying around and all this crap on the ground and everything. Now the whole thing is one nice, clean field, you know, flat, even, well raked, you know. Is that? Did we get there? Did it really, in your mind, become a clear, clean, open field? Establishing these three, which is very, this whole concept is very tricky. Establishing the three groups, right? With regard, the three very groups of constructs, dependent things, and emptiness itself, right? Total, what we call totality. Establishing those three in the same manner through using these three ideas with regard to unchanging things is a little tricky, right? What was our arena? Our arena was changing things. Now if you go on and use, if you try to explain these, the existence of the three elements with regard to unchanging things, or by using unchanging things as your arena, little bit tricky, okay? It's a little bit tricky. That's going to be a little bit of a tricky thing. We got a little bit left, just a little bit of cleanup work to do. Mop up. There's a little bit of mop up to do with establishing what it means to be a construct. We're just about at the end of it. Remember, we are trying to identify what it means to be a construct. We got most of our work is done. We got a little mop up to do about it. We'll try to get to that other point. You know, we'll cover that. You know, how do those three groups apply to things which don't change, unproduced things? But right now, all we next time we'll just try to do a little bit. Of, at the beginning, we'll just do a little mop up work on constructs, and then we'll move on. Okay. So okay, just to wrap up, just a little concluding dessert. We're talking about this stick. Got this stick here. And don't forget what school we're in. We're in the mind-only school. And I'm going to come up to you, and somebody's going to walk up to you and say, hey, what's the yongdu? What's the totality? How do you describe the emptiness of the stick, please?
The fact that that construct that stands between the mind and the object.
Well, I guess if I could put a question back, are we talking about the totality, the emptiness of the stick?
Yeah.
Or of the concept?
We're talking about the stick, the basis, the thing which is empty. Okay. How would you characterize the totality, meaning the emptiness of the stick, in terms of the mind-only school's language, using their concepts?
I would have said the absence of the construct of the stick having any existence independent of the constructing mind is the totality of the stick.
Tope kun takpe kun tak tope 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 matape kundak de tonshi tendu madupati yondubes. Tope madupe. You got. With regard to the, he says, you're close, but you need a bit of a brace to walk down the street. Yours was pretty clear, and yours was concordant with theirs. But he says, the one it is that from the beginning, the fact that from the beginning, I lost it. To make it easier, you've got the kid that's named Tashi. You have the state of the mind that calls it Tashi and creates the concept or the construct of Tashi. And then you have the construct of Tashi as a kid. Tashi the kid as a construct, which does exist. But the absence, with the fact that the boy does not have any nature of having a construct which applies to him, which construct is existing by definition. The fact that a construct which existed by definition could never apply to the boy is the emptiness of the boy. And that's pretty much, yeah, I think that's pretty much what Robin said.
And that was the one that was non-existent?
The pugudi tendu megyu kundati roas, the megyu kundati ki tongshi tendu mebadi, exactly. Yeah. The fact that the non-existent construct doesn't exist with the boy. The fact that the boy doesn't have the construct which doesn't exist is the boy's totality, meaning the boy's emptiness. But you could also, you know, and sort of express it, don't forget you can also always say that the existing construct does apply to the boy, right? That the existing construct, which is not something which exists by definition, mm-hmm. right? That the existing construct, which is just, that the fact that the existing construct, which doesn't come through any nature of its own, from its own side through any unique nature, the fact that that applies to the boy, you can also get into that. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's another way of, you could get into that also. See, you don't only have to go at it from the point of view of the construct which doesn't exist. You could say the fact that the construct which does exist doesn't apply to the boy as a thing which comes from its own side is also related to the boy's emptiness.
But there's the two ways of the constructs anyway. That's the two divisions of the construct.
Yeah. Daganari.
Okay.
So he said just before he said it, I feel a little uncomfortable if you just define it in terms of the construct which doesn't exist. Because you could also describe it in terms of the construct which doesn't exist, not applying to the boy as a construct which exists through any unique nature of its own from its own side. Phew.
Nice.
Now, I want to ask a little bit more question. Ran out of time, but we'll ask one more question. Pagging on last question, Senor. Pagging Arila and Aunt Ninja, Daddy Tama, Tama, Young Sian's Lagger. Okay, last question. There's this construct of Tashi the boy, right? There's this construct of Tashi the boy, and it applies to Tashi, right? It didn't apply to Tashi when the boy first came out, right? There wasn't a concept called Tashi the boy that applied to the baby when it just came out of the womb. But can you say that there's a concept of Tashi the boy which applies to the boy later, after it's been named? Dagaranes, Tashi, Pugu di Tashi Yimbas, Pugu Tashi Yimbe Kundadi, Tashi Gitendu, that Shapu Chingi Jela di Yimba, did do good, did not good. So I go along. I remember that your first point was that the construct which doesn't exist, the construct which existed from its own accord or something like that, that doesn't exist on top of the boy, of the later, on top of the boy named Tashi. Did Chegang and Lesha, Jedi.
Did it one?
Then make you Darti Tendu Madros, make you Kundati Tendu Madros.
Quitting do Nepas,
Nepadi,
Kajarangi,
Maso.
Inaya Tashi, Kotashi, Ming to be she, but you are.
Yeah, and so he just wanted to point out that the real emptiness or the real totality of Tashi is that the idea or the construct, Tashi the boy, in its self-existent form, right? As something which comes of its own accord from its own side and is not just something constructed by your mind. The fact that that does not exist, or that the fact that Tashi does not have just that kind of kundan, that kind of construct, is the yondub, is the totality, is the emptiness of Tashi. And I agree with you, and I think it's important to say that the fact that when you speak about the construct which does exist, the construct of Tashi the boy, which does exist, the fact that you have to keep repeating that does exist with Tashi, that Tashi does have that, that you do have to say. You have to be careful not to describe the emptiness of Tashi as in any way as being directly related to the idea that to the construct which does exist, because that would be dangerous. He said, I like the way you did it in the first place. Is a good way to do it like that. And then there's another idea in mind only, the fact that Tashi is the thing called Tashi. Okay? The fact that Tashi is the thing called Tashi. Now whether that exists by definition. Okay, that's what he's saying. He's sort of getting us ready for that. The fact that Tashi is the thing called Tashi. Now we gotta talk about that. Okay? What's its nature? Does that exist by definition? Tashi seya ki shi yimba. Di tani ki duba yina mena da di na nyok chai.
Tashi yimba ku pubu.
Tashi seya ki juk shi yimba.
Rangi tani ki chup giyo na chung ngayi matu bi taa ko seya wa.
Rangi
tani chup sana.
We're getting into a whole other question, but I like it because I've always wondered about it. The fact that Tashi is the thing called Tashi, does that exist by definition?
Fact or Tashi's being Tashi by definition?
No.
The fact.
The fact of tashi is the thing called tashi. Does that exist by definition? It would seem to be you'd want to say yes, right? He's kind of got it twisted around to the thing that's called tashi being something that exists from its own side. I don't know. I guess you'd say, tashi being called tashi, does that exist by definition? And he says, no. And he says, why? What's the indication? He says, that's not such a hard one. The fact that tashi is called tashi, the fact that tashi is the thing called tashi, doesn't exist by definition, because if the fact that the thing called, if the fact that tashi is the thing called tashi existed by definition, the minute the kid popped out, everybody would have called him tashi.
Yeah.
That's hard for me. Tashi se agitani jupi jukshi yimba, yimba de, rangi tseni ki madup de, Pugu tu ma thak tu dilat tashi segi mebe chen.
Oh, kima se bi jin ku ang su ang che shu se na. Dine kora tashi segu tu san bi sambo ku ang che shen shang sa ma kui chang. Wang cha ku ki ni. Wang cha ka ku ki ni. Ta ko yu ta me ku ku wang cha si ma. Ko yu ti za shi ne ho le song ma to. Di sambo ku me tu ko zan mi lu wa.
Another indication of that is not just that he wasn't called Tashi the minute he popped out. Another indication of that is that who is it that has the most authority in creating this baby called, in creating, quote, Tashi the baby, Tashi the boy? Who is it that has the most power? It's the state of mind that calls him Tashi, right?
Yeah.
That's the one who has the authority to create the thing called Tashi the boy. And that didn't happen until later, right? That doesn't happen of its own accord. And that's another indication that thing doesn't exist by definition. The fact that Tashi is called Tashi doesn't exist by definition, because it's the state of mind that names him Tashi that has authority over the whole matter, and that didn't happen until later.
Nothing.
Okay? Michael's not lying when he says last question, because each preceding one is the last question at that point. At that point, it becomes the last
question.
He says, It worked in your mind, and then you got it, and you started giggling. Okay, ready? Pukki joshi me tutam Rirabrikshi ninde gyambadi Sangye shindu me te uvagi Drogo namdakshin lacha parsho Idam guru radna mandala kamme atayami Vadi kya okun sanam yeshe tsozo shin Sanam yeshe me chue Dabba kunyi dobha sho
Touching again. Oh boy.